Hello friends and welcome back to another video. Today I have another documentary style film breakdown. This was a project that I recently completed for a local ministry, and the main point of this project was just to showcase the impact that this particular ministry has had on individuals within the community, as well as they were celebrating a 10-year anniversary. So we wanted to tell a little bit of the story of both organizations and how they have grown over time. I'm making this video in hopes that it would be helpful to you if you are filming a similar style film or you are commonly filming interviews. I always find videos like this very helpful. There's going to be timestamps below. If you want to skip ahead to a certain section, feel free. But to start off, I'm just going to play the film and then we'll come back and talk about it.
We have been chasing teen moms in Topeka for 10 years, and that seems like a long time, but it doesn't feel like a long time. Teen moms have probably been the strongest population I have ever met. And before I began to meet some of the moms, I was on my way to another job at the time, and I would pass the high school every day, Highland Park, and I thought they need to know Jesus, so I would pray for the kids. And I would say, Lord, would you draw the staff and the students' heart at Highland Park High School? I had gone to a banquet 12 years ago at Topeka High, gotten invited to a Young Life banquet. They showed a video on Young Life in the lives of teen moms called Young Lives. And I know that the Lord just laid a passion on my heart for them. We didn't have Young Lives in Topeka. I had no model of what it looked like. And I had to come in a way and say that we're not programmatic. We don't fix, we're not granted, we're not here to teach teen moms. We're here to come alongside them, shoulder to shoulder, to walk together. And they could not have opened the door wider for us. We had full access to the school anytime. They never put restrictions on us. They wanted what was best for their students, and we proved that we were an entity for those kids that would fight for them too.
I remember meeting Deb by another teen mom named, her name was Char. It's really hard to like put my trust into someone new, but I don't know, it's just something about her that I felt really comfortable with. I kind of see her as a mom, a grandma maybe, more than, I don't know, because I personally, me, lost my mom at 9.
Was aware that there was a mission that was an outreach for individuals with disabilities, and I really thought that Topeka is a place that this would be perfect for. So I started looking into Young Life. I worked at Washburn Rural High School. As I witnessed the impact that Young Life was having on the high school, I started doing a little research, found out they had a mission for special needs kids, not knowing really that was God's plan for me and that He was putting that on my heart. Jumped in the car and drove to Colorado for a beautiful week in the Colorado Mountains at Young Life Camp, and we instantly knew what the appeal was. Came back and started our first Capernaum fall of 2012, and we have been plugging along ever since.
So my name is Leif Davis Gerhardt, and I've been doing this for 10 years from Capernaum to start. There's been a lot of struggles in my life, going through my parents getting divorced. But I feel like it's kind of hard for me to say, but it's kind of hard.
And so from there, I had to grow up at literally starting at 9 years old. I had to learn how to cook for myself, wash my clothes, clean the house all the time, every day after school. And my whole personality just shut down. And I just kind of just wanted to give up.
One of the neat things with all the girls getting together at different ages, we have some girls that have graduated already and some girls that were still in school, is they met together in a way that felt like we're in this together. Like we all have something in common, we're not getting sleep. They knew each other, they got to know each other, and they knew exactly what their days and nights were like. And so they bond together in a way that's just natural because they all have kiddos, cute kids.
Yeah, it felt so natural walking into her house and knowing that the other moms understand what I'm going through.
So a big part of Young Life is to have students get to Young Life camp. And that's where I met Luke, who is in a cabin in Colorado. It is a prayer of our staff and our leaders that every student get a chance to meet Jesus. And Luke is an answer to that prayer. Getting to watch that has been a blessing in my life. One word I would use to describe Luke is joy. And that I see a joy in his face at whatever task he's about.
And Capernaum feels like I can do more for myself. When I was there, I feel like I'm opening up to another world, because when I'm there, I feel like everyone helped me getting through what I want to do.
She's strong, like really strong. And I think one of the things that we discover is that they teach us more than we teach them. I cannot imagine my life without them, because they have shown me strength in a way that I've never seen before. I'm the one that is blessed because I'm the one that gets to hang out with them. And they teach me and model to me more love and compassion in an entity that I don't see anyplace else.
I used to go to church with my mom every morning on Sundays. And then I kind of stopped going to church for a while after she passed away and we had her funeral and everything. I kind of got reconnected with him again by Deb. Just opened me up more to him, knowing that he loves us and he can hear us.
I feel like God is like a part of everyone's lives. But sometimes I like to keep out to my community, because I've been talking to a few of my friends. And it's not all about yourself, but I'm not sure you guys heard about this. I like to serve food for homeless people. All those people that don't have everything they don't have to get. I'm trying to give back to the community what Jesus did for everyone, because he died on that cross for everyone who lives on this earth.
People on the margins are on the margins because we put them there, and that we need to figure out a way to bring them in, and Capernaum is a vehicle to do that. We quickly find out our friends with disabilities and our friends without disabilities have much more in common, and they are much more alike than they are different. And our friends with disabilities share the love of Christ just by simply being who they are.
The Lord says, therefore go. You have no idea what it looks like, but you're willing to go. And we've gone for 10 years, therefore, and we get to watch them and encourage them, but they also show us how strong and what therefore looks like as we go.
My hopes for my son, Santiago, are to love and trust in Jesus how I do, to know that Jesus loves him and he always will.
I just want to say a big thank you for everyone who's doing this. Thank you for bringing me out here and doing all this. It means a lot to me, and thank you for doing the interview.
Getting started with a little bit of project overview. This was supposed to be an 8 to 9 minute documentary style film. We filmed this in one day, and it featured 4 interviews and some quick B-roll in 2 different locations. So we had the interview location as well as 2 different spots for B-roll that were relatively close by. The space where we filmed the interviews was a sort of auxiliary space connected to a friend's coffee shop. And so they recently got this space and it's primarily used for storage, but they do have hopes to do some photo and video projects out of it. And so it was a great kind of first trial of using this as a recording space. As far as crew, it was just me and my wife. And then the client was actually there to do the interviewing and asking the questions. So my main role was just to come in and light this and capture it as best I could. I want to touch briefly on camera and lenses. And so this was shot with 2 Fujifilm X-H2Ss. I had mine, and then I was borrowing my friend John's. And I was using the Sigma Art 18-35 on the A-cam, and the B-cam had the Sigma 24-70. One thing that I was trying on this particular interview was trying some different filters. And so these were shot with the Glimmer Glass 1 filters from Tiffin. I was just trying them out on this shoot. And so you guys will notice a little bit of a softer look, and that was primarily due to using these filters. Both cameras were running identical settings. That was 4K, 23.976 frames per second, 200 megabytes per second in Longop 422. And the picture profile was classic chrome with a few custom tweaks. If you guys are interested in my complete walkthrough of the settings that I use for my Fujifilm cameras for video, I have a whole video that I recently did, and so I will link that below for you guys to check out. So moving on to the setup for this video, this room was pretty much a blank canvas. I did have to move a few things out of the way, but the first thing that I brought in and got set up was this backdrop. And so this is a Superior Seamless Paper backdrop in the snow color. I think it's number 28. And this is just a backdrop that I had from a previous project. And because the room was all white, I figured that this would complement the space nicely. And so I set it up with the windows behind it. I did this because these were the biggest windows in the space, and I knew that I wasn't going to be able to control the light coming in through these windows. And so thankfully it was a cloudy, overcast day, so the light was really consistent. But I did want those windows behind the paper backdrop because I knew that they would give my subject a little bit of a backlight, and that would be something that I wouldn't need to add in myself. After I had the backdrop set up, I went ahead and placed a chair for the subject and moved on to getting my cameras set up and trying to find the frame that looked good to my eye. And so there was this wider angle where you can see the backdrop as well as a little bit of the background, and then this side angle that was a tighter shot on our subject. For my key light, I was using the Nanlight FS300, around 100% going into this 9x9 sheet of bleached muslin. You guys have seen me use this on previous projects, but it's basically just a huge piece of white fabric that I got from a fabric store, and it works great for creating a really large sheet of diffusion on the fly. The next light I want to talk about was the Nanlight FS60B that I had on the floor, and this was creating just a little bit of a streak on our backdrop. I did want to add just a little bit of texture because I had some extra time, and so that is where that light is coming from. You guys will see in the film, I did make a slight mistake with the FS60B. I don't think that I flagged it off properly. There ended up being a weird streak of light hitting the shadow side of my subject's face, which I was a little bit disappointed, but I do want to show you guys these things because I'm always learning, and even I don't do things perfectly. And so yeah, if I had to go back, I would have made sure to flag off that light correctly so that there was no spill hitting the subjects. I really enjoyed using both of these lights from Nanlight because they do allow me to dim them wirelessly with my phone, and that has been super helpful when I'm filming a lot of interviews like this where I don't have a lot of crew around to help me. It is so nice to be able to sit behind the camera and simply control these lights with my phone. Originally, I did place a Quasar T8 tube above the backdrop to use as a backlight on our subject, but I did end up removing this because I didn't feel like it was needed and I thought it was a little bit distracting. So if you do see that in some of the BTS, just know that I did remove that later on. The only other light that I added that I don't think is super necessary was this falconized light mat. I just placed it on the floor, kind of frame right, and turned this on 100%. The main reason was just to brighten up this wall a little bit more for the side camera angle. As you guys will see from the BTS, it doesn't add a whole lot. And so if I were to do this again, I wouldn't necessarily need to place this light there. To finish off our setup, I did have three big black moving blankets hung to the side of our subject to act as negative fill. And this was done just to soak up a little bit of the light because this space was very bright and all the walls were white and the light was just bouncing everywhere. So I did add these to the left side of the frame to suck up a little bit of that light. The last spot that I decided to remove some light was just this window. This was coming in towards our subject and the light was kind of changing throughout the day. So I went ahead and put this large 5-in-1 reflector in the window, and that ensured that we had as much control over the lighting from that area as possible. I think I could have gotten away with just the Nanlite FS300, and I didn't even need to use this large of diffusion. I could have used something like a softbox or one of my 5-in-1 reflectors. I just wanted to try this out, to try and create a very large source because we had the space. And so, yeah, don't be intimidated by all the gear in this setup. You really could keep things quite simple and achieve a really similar result. Okay, so now I'm just gonna do a quick lighting breakdown where we turn all the lights off and slowly turn them on. And so this is the room with just natural light. And then this is adding our key light. Here is adding the streak of light to the background. And then here is the key light off. And then here is the key light back on. And then this is showing the light mat that was brightening up the corner. For audio, I was just running the Sennheiser MKE600 straight into the Fujifilm X-H2S with a long XLR cable, and I thought the audio turned out really good. Moving on to the B-roll portion of this video, this was all captured incredibly quickly because our subjects did not have a lot of time the day of that we filmed, and so I grabbed one of the Fujifilm X-H2Ss and my Sigma R18-35 with the Glimmer Glass 1 filter and changed the settings to 60 frames per second, and we proceeded to go across the street to a coffee shop to capture this first bit of B-roll. And so I just had our subjects by some large windows. I wanted to make sure that the light was sort of backlighting them. And so you will see some of this footage here. And this was done just with natural light. We did not really have time to set up lights, and the coffee shop was also open and they did not want us filming with large lights. And so yeah, this was just making the most of what we had. And I feel like the footage turned out great for what we needed it for. So after this, we moved on to shoot the B-roll at the park. And again, there was no lights, no modifiers used in this footage. This was all just natural light shooting in 60 frames per second. And I just had our subjects play at the park and kind of captured them in their natural environment. I think this turned out great because we did have an overcast day. I probably would not have recommended shooting here if it was a bright sunny day, because this was probably around noon or 1 o'clock and the lighting would have been quite harsh. When it comes to post-production, all the music for this film was licensed via MusicBed. I think they have the best music library out there for affordable music for films like this. And I think it really just helps with the emotional tone of this film. It helps it really connect with an audience. I think there are a lot of other good sites out there, but at times I find it difficult to find a song that really is moving emotionally. And so check out MusicBed if you guys have not checked them out. I'll put a link below where you guys can sign up for a subscription. You guys will see in the film a little bit of footage that is not just the interviews and B-roll footage. And so there was another project that I had already done for this nonprofit on a separate shoot day where we captured some footage around the city. And so you guys will see some of that footage in the film that I pulled. It was really easy just to give some context to some of the things that were being described. And you will also see some footage from Colorado. And this was just footage that I had on my own hard drive. And when I heard the interviewee mention Colorado, I instantly thought how I potentially had some of my own footage that I could use to supplement and help give some context to the viewers. If you guys don't end up in a scenario like that and you are looking for some footage to supplement your work, do check out ArtGrid. I use them all the time in films like this. They have a ton of footage from a wide variety of locations. I think ArtGrid is one of the highest quality film licensing libraries out there that is still relatively affordable. I know Film Supply is incredible, but their prices are just quite high. And so there's a link below if you guys do want to check out ArtGrid and consider adding some of their footage to your next project. Another large element of post-production was all the pictures. And so these were given to me by the client, and these were just used to supplement the story and give context as needed. We did not have time or budget to really go out and shoot more B-roll beyond this one day. And so I feel like the pictures did a great job of helping to tell the story. And I simply turned these black and white just for consistency, because some were shot, you know, indoors, outdoors, on a phone, and I just softened them up, giving them more of a film look. And I felt like this really helped the photos blend cohesively and add to the storytelling of this piece. I did do some basic sound design, added some simple environmental sound effects, as well as the projector sound that you hear underneath all of the photos. I think little aspects like this are really subtle, but they do add to the final piece really feeling cohesive and professional. I finished off post-production with the color grade. And so for these, I graded this entire piece using my Meta LUTs and film effects. It made the process incredibly easy and relatively quick, and I really loved how they turned out. And so I will show you guys some before and afters here. If you guys are interested in checking them out, there's a link below where you guys can see about incorporating them into your own workflow. Thank you guys so much for checking this video out. Please let me know down below if you have any questions or I missed anything. I really love to be a resource to you guys and show you my process. I know that it might not be perfect, and there's, you know, plenty of people who could probably do a project like this better than me, but I would hope that sharing my process of how I've approached creating films like this would be helpful to you, that you'd be able to take something away from it. And so, yeah, until next time, peace.